Thank you very much for having me. Thank you, Matt, for inviting me. I wasn't entirely sure what exactly to talk about, so I'm going to talk about boats. A lot about boats and the adventures that I've taken some students on in the last 2 years. I'm just starting my third year in business, so I'll talk a little bit about how I, the trials and tribulations of starting up a company, particularly a company that's a little bit ridiculous like this. It's a bit of a stretch getting us all to work. So I'm from North Vancouver, but grew up sailing in West Van. First at Hollyburn down in Appleside, and then they didn't have the more advanced dinghy programs for kids at that point in time, so I moved over to Eagle Harbor in the top left corner there and just fell in love with it. And I basically haven't left since. I've been sailing there since I was 12 years old. It's quite a while ago now. I got into coaching dinghies, coaching kids' race teams, running all the sailing programs at Eagle Harbor. I did move over to Kent's Yacht Club at one point for work, but continued to sail at Eagle Harbor for fun when I was at UBC for undergrad and grad school. It was just more convenient to be on the other side of the bridge at that point in time. And then, as my introduction said, I felt that need to be a responsible adult and have whatever a real job is. I'm still trying to figure that out, but I gave it a go. I worked in the clean tech sector for a number of years, and that job took me to England. I got transferred, I volunteered to be transferred over to the company office there. And looking around in the UK, sailing is very different from here. Here, unless you're in the sailing world, it's often perceived as very, very elitist, which anyone who's had to clean up the bilge of a boat knows that there's nothing glamorous about it whatsoever. It has nothing to do with the marketing brochures. And in the UK, it's much more part of the culture. I was living on the South Coast, and the opportunities to sail in things like the Fastnet, which is the top right corner, were getting rolled by a Russian billionaire's boat, that picture. The opportunities were incredible, and I thought, you know, I think there's room in Vancouver to do this. I'm gonna challenge the training, because I already had all the experience, I just didn't have any paperwork behind me. I'm gonna challenge the training and go through the whole Royal Yachting Association program and try and bring this back home. So I worked there for a couple years, and as a charter skipper, I had the opportunity to work for an all-female company with all-female instructors, all-female students, and I ran charters in the Canary Islands, which is the bottom left, very sunny, nice picture. But that whole time, home was calling me. My whole family's here, all my friends are here, and it was time to come back. If you could press the button for me now.
Yeah.
So I came home and decided that with basically no money and no boat, I was going to start a sailing company. It was a questionable decision, probably, but it's worked out so far. And I found the second I sort of said that this is what I wanted to do, this was truly my passion, people came out of the woodwork to help me. So I sort of made a small announcement at Eagle Harbor Yacht Club, and three members just offered their boats for me to use, which your boat is like your child, so that's kind of a big deal to have people just trust you enough to take their baby off the dock and start to teach beginners. So that's how I got started. The first 6 months were very much winging it on other people's boats until I managed to find my own. Very questionable, non-grown-up decisions. Of purchasing an asset, which a boat is never an asset, it's a massive liability. Purchasing that 1 month after buying a tiny one-bedroom apartment in Vancouver's really fun real estate market. So I sort of rolled the dice and gambled it all in trying to make this concept work. But again, with so much support from family and friends and the sailing community, it was a little bit overwhelming, and we're sort of up and running. Oh, it's working. So in first year of running Sea to Sky, I decided I wanted to have a focus on encouraging more young people to either stick with sailing once they've kind of aged out of the kids' duty programs, or to start if they never had the opportunity to do that earlier, you know, as children when it's quite easy and structured to get into sailing. There's no clear path to go from the little boats to the big boats, and the opportunities to continue sailing in the little boats fade away as you get a little bit older. So I sort of envisioned creating a bridge between those two worlds to keep people more involved in the sailing community for their whole life, not just as children or not just when they could retire and would have the time to do it, but to carry on the whole way through. So I started a youth apprenticeship program where I take on two young adults between the ages of 16 and 25 each year, and they shadow me. So they do as much as they can with me. They're invited on board for every course, every race, to develop their sailing skills in a fairly intensive sort of a way, including all the non-brochure, non-glamorous aspects of learning how to maintain the boat, because without those skills, it's not a viable activity for most people. If you're having to pay professionals to come and look after every little thing on the boat, you're not gonna have a boat for very long. So it was a pretty incredible first year. And I also decided to have more of a focus on racing than other sailing schools in the area are very focused on traditional cruising skills. People in the racing community, I've always been in the racing community, it feels easy to be part of it. Everyone knows that boats are looking for crew at all times. But if you're not in that world already, you don't know that, and there's no obvious way to get out sailing. So I sort of thought that I'd try and enliven that side of things. In the first year, I sailed over 1,000 miles. I guess that was in 9 months, actually. I sailed over 1,000 miles with the new boat, and it was a completely incredible year. I got voted runner-up best adventure travel company in Vancouver under the Georgia Strait, which I couldn't stop smiling for a whole month when that happened. It was just incredible. I've met so many interesting people coming on board with me to train, and it was really pretty amazing. So then I thought, why stop there? Why just stick with this kind of basic structure? Let's get a little crazy and do some major adventures. So this is where I started kind of a 5-year plan for doing a major adventure expedition every year. So in 2017, I took a team entirely of students, none of whom had been sailing for more than 14 months. I took them around Vancouver Island in the Van Al 360, which is one of the most challenging races in the Pacific Northwest. It was pretty brutal, but it was the experience of a lifetime, and I think everyone had a pretty good time. You can see my amazing parents actually followed us around the island in a van, a very disreputable van, filled with all of our spare equipment and food. My mom fed the whole team for 14 days. It was absolutely amazing. And my dad bragged at the end that they drove twice as far as we sailed, because we had to go back and forth from the store so many times. So again, it's very much a family affair to get this kind of thing up and running. And that one you can click from Vancouver onto some pretty cool race boats in the Caribbean to escape our winter, and also kind of see what that next level of racing is like. Because there's a whole world out there that often Vancouver can be like a little village, especially in the sailing world, that we are far away from from the rest of the world. So having opportunities to truly take sailing to the next level and sail abroad is has always been one of my goals, to be able to help students do that. And this year, our big expedition this year is to do the Race to Alaska. So I'm now just starting my third season in business. I'm clearly losing my mind because I got a second boat, because one wasn't quite enough work. So I got a second very small boat specifically to do the race to Alaska. So Sea Disguised Alien is sponsoring a team of my students to do this slightly crazy race that is 750 miles from Victoria to Ketchikan, Alaska, with no engine on the boat at all. So you have no safety net. It's been labeled the America's Cup for dirtbags, but most people, their boats cost less than their cars. You can do whatever you want to it, and it's just whoever gets there first wins. There's no handicap rating system or anything like that. It's just go. Last year, one guy did it on a stand-up paddleboard. He paddled the entire Inside Passage to Ketchikan. People have done it in kayaks, or they've gotten part of the way in kayaks. Hobie cat dinghies, this sort of insanity. So my tiny 27-foot boat that the toilet is just in the middle of the boat, wave at people while you use it, has no luxury, no comfort whatsoever. That seems relatively sane compared to what other people are taking on this race. And I guess because of, because of the storytelling that comes with this sort of adventure, we started to partner with some companies that are helping make it possible. So we've got gear from Mustang Survival. We have a Canadian company in the Rockies actually doing dehydrated meals so that we can cut down weight on the boat and hopefully be a little bit more competitive. And we're getting some of the really high-end coolers that you can get from Yeti so we can actually keep some fresh food cold for the whole time instead of just surviving on dehydrated stuff. And it's gonna be a bit ridiculous. So that's in June. We're gonna get to Ketchikan, sleep for 24 hours, and then I have to turn around and bring the boat back. I have to make it back in time for my dad's 80th birthday. I missed the last one, because he was busy chasing me around Vancouver Island in a van during his 79th birthday. I figured I better make it home in time for the 80th, because that's kind of a big deal. And the last slide. So that's what I do. Sea Disguised Alien is sort of aiming to be that bridge or that open door into the sailing world, to kind of move away from that elitist image and show people that it's something anyone can do at any level if you have that hunger for pushing your limits and seeing what's out there. That's all I got for you.
It's an interesting point that you make about just growing up and wanting to do that but not really sure and not really being part of it. And when you said Fastnet,
yes.
is that off Baltimore and off the south?
No,
of Ireland, or?
Yeah.
So I spent some time in Baltimore, and it is very much a part of life though.
Yeah.
You're either on land or you're in the water, like you're jumping back and forth all the time. I haven't spent a lot of time there. But we actually got onto the Fastnet a little bit.
Cool.
And apparently that doesn't happen very often.
No.
The
weather's horrible there all the time.
Jump off, stay up there for a while, see some seals and stuff, and then jump back on. And they said that probably we were the only people that did that in the past 10 years.
Yeah. It was
it was
a bit rough when I went around.
It is rough.
There's no way anyone was getting off the boat willingly.
Yeah.
Katie, thank you so much for being here this morning. It was a really fascinating presentation. Mm-hmm. And I think we're all struck not only by what a wonderful, well, it sounds like a wonderful lifestyle, but also it sounds like a heck of a lot of work, and the inspiration that you provide to young people, and in bridging that gap between sort of young people and the sailors, absolutely critical. On behalf of the club, we are going to make a contribution this morning to our Polio Plus program to say thank you to you, and Rotary has been involved in this public-private partnership since 1988, and about $5 billion has been invested in the Polio Plus program. We're now partnering with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and the Canadian government, and the world is now 99% polio-free. So we'll do this on your behalf and provide you with a pen to cast of thousands, probably. Good luck.
Thank you so much.